So I'll just give you a recap of what we had done before the break. Can you see the screen, students?
Yes.
Okay, beta. So in the last class, we had started with chapter of function of more than one variables, function of more than one variables. So we have something like, we will be concentrating on function of two variables. So that is, your input is x and y and your output is a number, right? Or you have a function of three variables, x, y, z. So your input is x, y, z and your output is another a number. So if you want to see this thing, so you have x and y, this is your domain, or a subset of x, y plane is your domain, and real number is your range, or a subset of real number is your range. Okay. And here you have x, y, and z. This is your domain, or a subset is a domain, and R, which is a real axis, is your range or codomain, right? You can call it codomain to be more precise, because range will be what is exactly obtained by that function. Okay. Is that thing clear? So we have discussed about function of more than one variables, and we were discussing after the definition of the function, after discussing their domain and range, we were discussing their limits. This is what we were doing in the last class. Okay. Now I am just concentrating on function of two variables for limits. So let me repeat the definition. So we are saying limit x, y going to a, comma b, f, x, y is L. It means that when x, y is close to a, b, close to a, comma b, the value f, x, y is close to L. Right? So here it means that if your point a, comma b is here, and your number L is here, if you are somewhere near A, comma B, your value of the function should be near L. So it means that if this is your X, comma Y, then the corresponding FX, comma Y should be close to L. This is the definition of limit XY going to AB, FXY is L, right? Now, after that, I told you, because when you have function of one variable, you have only two ways to approach a comma b, that is either from left hand side or from right hand side. If you have function of one variable, note, if you have function of one variable, there are only two ways, left hand limit and right hand limit. Only left hand limit and right hand limit for f of x, if you have a function of one variable. Okay, that is why you just check left hand limit and right hand limit. If they are equal, you say that your limit exists, right? But for function of two variables, we have already done these things in the last class. I'm just revising. For function of two variables, fx, y, right? If you want to approach point A, comma B, there are infinitely many paths. For example, these straight lines, okay? And not only these straight lines, there may be circles or parabolas. There are infinite kind of curves, right? By which, along which you can approach A, comma B. So for function of two variables, there are infinite paths to approach A, comma B, right? Therefore, if limit x, y, comma a, b, going to x, comma y, going to a, comma b, f, x, y, suppose you have a path, say y is equal to some path involving m and some function of x, suppose x raised to power a. So if you are computing this limit, so you compute this limit along this path, so you will have limit x going to 0, f x y you will replace with m x raised to power a, right? If this depends on m, then you say limit does not exist. Why? Because if this depends on M, okay, depends on M, it means that along different paths you are getting different limits. Therefore, limit does not exist. This is, you should note it carefully. If it does not depend on M, if it does not depend on M, then you will not say that limit exists. Why? Because y is equal to m x raised to power alpha or a is one type of path. There are infinite other, consider all the types. So this method where you will put y is equal to m x raised to power something, that will work only to when your answer is negative, in the sense when the limit does not exist. Right? Limit x, y going to 0, 0.
Ma'am,
check limit does not
exist. You are not audible.
Yes, beta. Yes, am I audible?
Ma'am, now you are audible. Earlier you was not.
Is that okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So can you tell me till here that if your limit is independent of M, you cannot say that limit does limit exists. Is that was clear? That what part was clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay. So now look at this question, 2x square y, x square plus y square. If I take y is equal to mx, what will happen? Limit xy going to, sorry, not xy, limit x going to 0, it will be 2x square mx upon x raised to power 4 plus m square x square. So this is, can you tell me how much? 2x square mx, x square common, x. You will have x square plus m square. X square and x square will cancel. Limit x going to 0. So this limit is 0. What can I say? Can I say? What can I say? Please, students, reply.
Independent of m.
Independent of m. Independent
of m, yes. But
limit exists.
Limit exists.
No, beta. Yehi toh main bata rahi hoon. This is what I am telling you, that if limit is independent of M, you will not say that limit exists. Why? Because there are, you have just considered one type of path. There are other types of paths also. That is what I am telling you. So you will not say anything. What can I say? You cannot comment on the existence of limit. Can't comment on existence of limit. If the limit is, you are doing one path and the limit is independent of M, you will not say that limit exists because you have just considered one path. There are other paths. Let me consider something else. If I consider y is equal to mx square, you see what will happen? Limit x going to 0, you will have 2x square mx square upon x raised to power 4 plus mx square raised to power 2. So that is 2m x raised to power 4, x raised to power 4, 1 plus m square. This x raised to power 4 and x raised to power 4 will cancel. So this will be 2m upon 1 plus m square, dependent on path. Therefore, does not exist. Now, is the picture clear in your mind? So when along any particular path, you get the limit is independent of M, you will say nothing about the existence. Either you test some other path, okay? So you have to test. If you are sure that limit does not exist, then you have to test till you get a path dependent limit. Okay? Is that thing clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you have to
अगर एक केस में अगर इंडिपेंडेंट आ रहा है एम के तो लाइक हम लोग को उसमें दूसरा पार्ट चेक करना ही करना पड़ेगा.
Yes, if the question is show that limit does not exist. Okay? Is that okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. So let me now tell you that how we will deal this. This is all we have done in the last lecture. That limit does not exist. How to check limit does not exist.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Ma'am, can I ask a question?
Yeah, but just a minute.
Okay.
Okay, student, you can ask the question, beta. Who was asking?
Yes, ma'am, like in this case where we actually when we are choosing a path such as y is equals to mx square, so do we assume that this path passes through the point 10, 0?
Which comma? 0, 0. Yes, beta. 0, 0.
So, ma'am, if we actually consider that this path passes through this point, and if yes. we are saying that we are considering a general path like y is equals to mx square, so then that would only be the case for a single m, right?
No, not a single m, because for all m's this is passing. No, your point is 0, 0. So whatever is the value of m, this is passing through 0, 0. Obviously this
but
path,
if we had something else like 10, 0 or that,
yeah, that you have to consider something else. For example, if you have say limit xy going to say 10, 0, right?
Yes.
Okay, so my point is here 10, 0. And I have some function here. So my y will be equal to what I have to take. You see, accordingly, if I'm just taking the straight lines.
So we can shift the origin to that point and then continue.
Yeah, no, you
our
can
analysis
just,
in the same way.
You can just write the equation of line y minus 0 upon x minus 10 is equal to m. So the equation of the line will be y is equal to m x minus 10 for all slopes.
Okay.
Right? You got
okay.
it?
Okay. Yes, ma'am, I got it. Thank you.
Okay, fine. So is this thing clear to everybody, beta? So please, this should be set in your mind that if the limit is path dependent, then you will say limit does not exist. If you are getting limit path independent, then you will not comment anything, right? So the question that should come into your mind is, then how are we going to find out if the limit exists? Okay, for not, I told you this method, this is called a path dependent method sometimes. Okay, path dependent method to test the non-existence of limits. Okay, beta, somebody is saying, ma'am, can you repeat? Prabh Simran, is that thing clear, beta? Is this thing clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, beta. Fine.
Ma'am, जैसे उसमें path independent आई थी, limit zero आ गई थी, तो हमें एक limit की finite value तो मिल गई थी ना, ma'am? जैसे path independent value.
No. See, I will tell you what is happening here. See, this is the point 0, 0. Here is this meaning is that if you are approaching along straight lines, everywhere, if you are approaching along straight lines, you have limit equal to zero. That is true. But the moment you approach along these are parabolas. Your limit is path dependent. It means that limit does not exist, na? Right? Did you get it? Because these are just one type of path. There are, even if you, here also suppose you get zero, then there is another type of path also. I have just considered two. So there is no way that you can consider all the paths because there are infinite paths. That is why you cannot say that limit exists.
Ma'am, so basically, there can be infinite paths which will have the limit existing at that certain point,
limit,
and
we will not say limit existing. There are infinite paths along which the limit is same. Okay, because existence.
Okay, same, yeah.
Yeah, existence means along every path it is same. Okay, so
okay,
what is
okay.
happening? That here in this case, what is happening? Along straight lines, everywhere you are getting zero. That is okay. But there are other paths also, right? Suppose along parabolas also you get zero. Then also you cannot say because there are other paths also. So if suppose somebody tries 100 paths and he or she is saying, no, I have tried 100 paths, but they are not enough because there are infinite paths. So you cannot use this technique to confirm the existence. Is that okay?
पर एक पॉइंट पे लिमिट एग्जिस्ट करने के लिए आपने बताया था कि डिफरेंट पाथ्स की अगर उस पॉइंट पे एग्जिस्ट हो रही है तो लिमिट एग्जिस्ट होएगी
नो बेटा लिमिट एग्जिस्टेंस मींस अलोंग एवरी पाथ द लिमिट विल बी सेम नाउ बिकॉज़ वी कैन नॉट टेस्ट अलोंग एवरी पाथ बिकॉज़ देयर आर फाइनाइट पाथ्स सो टिल नाउ आई हैव नॉट टोल्ड यू दैट हाउ यू विल चेक दैट द लिमिट एग्जिस्ट ओके आई हैव जस्ट टोल्ड यू हाउ यू विल चेक दैट लिमिट डज नॉट एग्जिस्ट फाइन
मैम कैन यू स्क्रॉल अप फॉर अ सेकंड Done, ma'am.
Okay, now I will tell you that how you are going to find out that limit exists. Okay, so for that, there is one technique which always works, but that is not in our course. But I will tell you a little bit because otherwise it will be a confusion in your minds. So one is called epsilon delta technique. It always works. Okay, fine. So what is this technique? This says given epsilon and delta, they are just numbers. Given epsilon, a positive number. Okay, let me write down like this. Epsilon greater than zero. A positive number is given. You should be able to find out another positive number delta. Such that f of xy, comma f of comma l is less than epsilon for all x comma y minus a comma b less than delta. Now you see, what is this? This is nothing but the definition. Here we are saying that given an epsilon, okay, you should be here is your point A comma B, here is your L. So given a epsilon means given a small neighborhood of L. Okay, what is this? This is this quantity here, that all those points where fx comma y is close to L by epsilon. It means that this is L plus epsilon, this is L minus epsilon. So it means that given that epsilon, you should be able to find out a delta. Delta means a neighborhood of A comma B such that all those xy which are here corresponding to that fxy is here. This is nothing but the definition that whenever you are close to A comma B, your fxy is close to L, right? But I will not do the problems on this basis, right? Because that is not in your syllabus. This is a deep thing to understand if you want to understand epsilon delta thing, but this is not in your syllabus. Let me write down it clearly because it is there in the books. So you can skip that part. Okay, so, but this is just the definition. Here we are saying whenever you have a neighborhood of L, okay, this is a neighborhood of L, epsilon neighborhood of L. It means that you are close to L. You should get a neighborhood of A comma B means you should find out that if you are this close to A comma B, fxy is for sure close to L. So this is just implementing the definition, right? So what we are going to do, second method, we are going to test only some particular cases for existence of limits. So what are those cases? So I have some results like first one is limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught x. Can you guess what will be this? Please, we are approaching x naught comma y naught. X will be x naught, right? Simple. because there is no y involved. Just put x is equal to x naught. Is that thing clear?
Yes.
Just
yes,
variable. So this result we are going to use. Second is limit x comma y, x naught comma y naught, y. What will be this number?
Y naught.
Third is limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught, a constant. What will be the limit? That constant. Right. So the next is, if limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught is fxy is L, and limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught gx comma y is M, then something called sum rule. Sum rule means limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught fxy plus gxy is L plus M. Is that thing clear? If this limit is existing, this limit is also there, then the sum will be limit of the sums will be sum of the limits. Is that thing clear? Next one is difference rule. So that says limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught fxy minus gxy is L minus M. Then you have product rule, which says limit x comma y going to x naught comma y naught fxy into gxy is L into M. Fine. Then you have limit xy going to x naught comma y naught some constant times fxy is
sequence series wale part mein.
Yes, beta.
Mummy, sequence and series wale part mein to tha. Ye wala
yes,
cheez,
beta, yeah. I'm just repeating because now we have function of two variables.
Okay, right? Ma'am.
So that is why I'm writing it again. Right. So next is quotient rule. This says that limit xy going to x naught comma y naught fxy upon gxy is L upon M provided M is non-zero. Right? And the last one is power rule, which says limit x comma y fx going to x naught comma y naught fxy raised to power say M upon N is equal to L raised to power M upon N. Fine. Now somebody was asking, can we use L'Hopital rule? Okay. So if the answer is you can use L'Hopital rule, but not very like what you use in one variable. So I will just give you a negative that you will not use L'Hopital rule for finding the limits of function of more than one variables. But it does not mean that I'm saying that it cannot be used. It can be used, but there is a different theory for how you can use L'Hopital rule for function of more than one variables. But for as far as our course is concerned, that theory is not applicable. So we will not use L'Hopital rule for the limits when we are having function of more than one variable, right? So now suppose I have this problem, limit xy going to 0 comma 1 x minus xy plus 3 upon x square y plus 5xy minus y cube. Can you tell me? You see here, if you put 0 comma 1 here, what you will get in the denominator? You will get 0 square into 1 plus 5, 0 into 1 minus 1 cube. So which is non-zero, right? So we can just find the limit as such. So it is by the quotient rule, this is limit of the numerator divided by limit of the denominator, right? So now the numerator, the limit will be 0 minus 0 into 1 plus 3. So your answer is 3 upon 4. 3 upon minus 1. So your answer is minus 3. Is that okay? So whenever there is a question of existence of limits, you will get these simple questions where you will be able to use simple rules, these rules which I have just written, to find out your limit. So let us do one more problem. Limit xy going to 3 comma minus 4 square root of x square plus y square. This will be equal to square root of limit xy going to 3 comma minus 4 x square plus y square, which is equal to 3 square plus minus 4 square, which is 5. Clear? Is that thing clear, beta?
मैम हमें एग्जाम में भी ऐसे ही लिखना होगा, मतलब अंडर रूट के अंदर ऐसे लिमिट लिख के फिर वैल्यूज पुट करके.
You can write simple also, but I'm just telling you because I'm using this power law here, right? But you can obviously skip some steps, right?
Okay.
Which obvious steps you can skip? Limit xy going to 0 comma 0 x square minus xy upon root x minus root y. Can you tell me now here? Right now, this is 0 by 0, right? But I know that I can rationalize. I'll just do this thing that you have. I am multiplying with x plus root x plus root y, root x plus root y. So in the numerator, I'll get x common, x minus y into root x plus root y. In the denominator, you have x minus y. Limit xy going to 0, 0. Now, because there is a cancellation, that is why you will get 0 into 0 plus root 0. So you here 0 is your limit. Do you understand? Here you are not using any path and you are getting your limit equal to 0. That is why limit does exist and is equal to 0. Clear? Is that thing clear? Any doubts, Vita, please ask.
I'm trying to scroll karte na upar.
Yeah, sure. Where, beta? Can you tell me?
Ma'am, rules se thoda pehle.
Okay. Here? You can skip this part, beta. This epsilon delta.
Just okay. Skip it.
Okay? Yeah. So, meanwhile, I would like to tell you people that right now we are doing exercise 12.1 and 12.2. Okay, so I think
please scroll down.
Yeah, sure. 12.1 and 12.
This week you will give a doubt class for previous chapter.
Yeah, I told you, but I forgot. Right now, what is the time? 12:40. Okay, so our class is still one. So can we do it tomorrow? Is that okay, beta? Sorry.
Tomorrow would be better.
Yeah, we can do it tomorrow, beta. Please keep your doubts. Okay. So right now we are doing 12.1 and 12.2 exercise. Okay, students. So I think tomorrow's lecture also till 12.2 we will cover. You should be doing these exercises from your book. I'll send you the problems also. Okay, so can we move ahead, students? Okay. So next question is, after limit, what do you study? Function, then limit, then next thing is, tell me,
continuity.
Yes, exactly. So next is continuity. So we say that fxy is continuous at xy equal to a comma b if, what is the definition? Tell me. Limit xy going to a comma b fxy is equal to what?
The value of the function at that point.
The value of the function at that point. The same definition is here also. Right? So continuity means that limit of the function should be same as the value of the function. So one thing is that limit should exist and moreover, it should be equal to the value of the function at that point. Clear? Clear, beta? This thing is clear to everybody?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. So, now, Can you give me examples of continuous functions? Any example of continuous function? Simplest example which you can think of?
Y is equals to mx.
Not y is equals to mx. Bida, now you understand you have function of two variables. I have this function of two variables. I can
conic.
Any polynomials? Polynomials are always continuous, Bida. Because whatever, if you are just computing limit xy going to a comma b of any polynomial, polynomial in two variables now, that will be equal to a square plus b square plus ab, which is equal to the value of the function. So polynomials are always continuous. Polynomials are always continuous. Clear? What else is continuous? Rationals are continuous except at the points where denominator is zero. Rational functions.
Exponential.
Fxy upon, yeah, exponential also. Gxy, where are continuous whenever gx comma y is not zero. And also next, exponential, yes, e raised to power, say x square minus y square. Okay, or e raised to power x minus y.
Ma'am, so trig functions in their domain, restricted in their domain, they are also, yeah, like continuous. So.
Sorry, beta, again, which function you are saying?
Trigonometric functions, yeah, in their domain. Yeah.
So these functions are continuous. Okay, trigonometric functions restricted to the domain. So these are the examples of continuous functions. Domains of definition means wherever the functions are defined. Is that okay? Now, log function is also continuous, right? Logarithmic. Again, in the domain. So question is, show that fxy is equal to 2xy upon x square plus y square when xy is not equal to 0, 0. And this is equal to 0 when xy equal to 0. So this is how the function is defined. Is continuous at every point except at origin. Except at origin. This is the problem. Do you understand that you have to show that this particular function which is given is continuous everywhere except at 0, 0. Right. So let us do this. When xy is not 0, 0. Okay, let us take a comma b. Right, we are proving the continuity at a comma b. When a comma b is not equal to 0, 0. In that case, limit xy going to a comma b, 2xy upon x square plus y square is what? Tell me. What is this limit? Just put a in place of x, b in place of y. Now, because a comma b is not equal to 0, 0, so the denominator is not 0. So this is a finite number. And what is the value of the function at that point? That is also 2ab upon a square plus b square. So they are equal. Therefore, everywhere where a comma b is not 0, 0, limit xy going to a comma b fxy is same as fab. Therefore, continuous. Is that thing clear? Is that thing clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, when you are talking about 0, 0, a comma b is 0, 0. In that case, you see limit xy going to 0, 0, we are going to find this limit 2xy upon x square plus y square. So now can you tell me how we will continue from here? This limit we are talking about. Already we have seen that how to deal
with y equals to mx.
Yeah, put y is equal to mx. So this will be limit x going to 0, 2x mx upon x square plus m square x square. So this is 2m x square will cancel, 1 plus m square, dependent on path. Therefore, limit does not exist. Limit does not exist. And hence, function is not continuous at 0, 0. This is how you will do these problems. Is that okay? Is that thing clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, please explain this question once again.
Yeah, sure, Buddha. You see, you have this problem that you are given a function fxy, which is defined as 2xy upon x square plus y square whenever x comma y is not equal to 0, 0, and it is 0 whenever x comma y is 0, 0. The question is clear. You have to show that this function is continuous everywhere except at origin, right? So what we have done, we have first taken a point A comma B where I will prove the continuity, and I'm taking this point other than 0, 0. So now if I try to find out the limit xy going to A comma B fxy, that will be equal to limit xy going to A comma B. This is a function 2xy upon x square plus y square. Now because A and B, they are not both equal to 0. So the denominator, if I put x is equal to A and y is equal to B, is non-zero. So I can just put it is equal to a square plus b square. So this is my limit, which is a finite number. And if I find the value of the function at a comma b, now because a comma b is not 0, 0, so this is the value. So I'll just put x is equal to a and y is equal to b. So limit and value, they are same. Therefore, function is continuous everywhere when we are at a point other than origin. Now let us come to origin. When a comma b is 0, 0, at that point, first you have to find the limit, because value of the function is 0. At 0, 0, the value of the function is 0. You have to just find the limit. Now you are trying to find out the limit of the function. So this is the function 2xy upon x square plus y square. So either the limit exists or limit does not exist. But we have already dealt with this problem that if you put y is equal to mx, so you'll get a path dependent limit. It means that limit does not exist. So if limit does not exist, function cannot be continuous. Is that thing clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, beta. So I'll give you some problems for your practice. Okay. Find limit x comma y going to 4 comma 3 root x minus root y plus 1 upon x minus y minus 1. And there is one more restriction. Okay, so this is your question. This is your homework, actually. You'll do it and you will tell me that what is the answer, and you have to make some observations also, right? Okay, so the next one I'm giving you, limit x comma y comma z going to minus 1 by 4 pi by 2 comma 2 tan inverse of xyz, right? This is simple. Here you just put x is equal to minus half. So this is equal to tan inverse of minus 1 by 4 into pi by 2 into 2. So this is tan inverse of minus pi by 4. So this is your answer. Okay, this is your homework. Now if you have any doubt, you can ask me. Tomorrow we'll start with, we are done with 12.2. Tomorrow we'll start with the next exercise, 12.3, partial derivatives. Okay, beta? Because after we have discussed function, then limit, and then continuity, and after that is differentiability. So tomorrow we'll start with this differentiability. Okay? Tomorrow we'll start from here.
Ma'am, I got a first question answer.
Sorry, beta?
Ma'am, I got first question
answer room.
Okay, what's the answer? What is your answer?
I'm 1/4.
Yes, 1/4 is the correct answer. But is there any restriction you are taking?
No, ma'am. No.
Yeah, okay. Fine. 1/4 is the correct answer. You have to rationalize, okay? You are using the you are doing rationalization, right, beta?
Ma'am, factorization of the denominator.
Yeah, you can do that, or you can just multiply with root x plus root y plus 1 and divide with root x plus root y. Okay, any other doubt, beta? We still have 2 minutes. If you have any other doubt, you can ask. Okay, then tomorrow we'll start with the new exercise 12.3, and we'll also have doubts from your last chapter. Thank you, everybody. Have a nice day.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, beta.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, beta.
Thank you, ma'am.